Hello and welcome, this is Paul Sandhu. This video that follows was originally created back about a year and a half ago in 2016, early 2017. It was posted on my old YouTube channel, which was terminated by YouTube earlier this year in 2018 for allegedly violating the community guidelines, okay? And on that channel, I believe all we had was a great deal of truth and exposés of the people, let us say, that sit atop the pyramid of this world and that run and guide this world, okay? So one of these people is Richard Byrd. And people have swallowed hook, line, and sinker the story of Admiral Richard E. Byrd and his alleged expeditions to the North and South Poles and his almost like, you know, Herculean myth about the Operation High Jump. Okay, so the video itself has all the information. Well, not all of it. There's lots more that I wanted to put into this video, but because of time restrictions, I could only, you know, give certain pieces that helped me piece the story together about the reality of Richard Byrd, his career, and his alleged operations to the polar regions, especially Operation High Jump. Now, first of all, I just want to quickly read a couple of things to you from his Wikipedia page. And this one is about his ancestry. So we can understand that Richard Byrd was a blue-blooded elite going back generations to European royalty. And as we understand, those of at least who follow the world for what it really is, the European royalty in particular are not in the business of bringing us truth and verity. They are in the business of controlling the masses through their lies and deceptions. Byrd was born in Winchester, Virginia, the son of Esther Bowling and Richard Evelyn Byrd Sr. He was a descendant of the first families of Virginia. His ancestors include planter John Rolfe and his wife Pocahontas. You guys probably all know about Pocahontas, right? So that's one of his ancestry going back in the United States, but we'll see that it goes back even further. William Byrd II of Vestor Plantation, who established Richmond. Those of you who live in Richmond, Virginia, yeah, this person, William Byrd II, he's the one that established that city, and he was an ancestor of Richard Byrd. And Robert King Carter, a colonial governor. These colonial governors were absolutely royalty in that they were appointed by the King of England and they served British royalty and they were in most cases cousins or otherwise related to the royals. So he comes from a royal bloodline. Okay, he was the brother of Virginia Governor and U.S. Senator Harry F. Byrd, a dominant figure in the Virginia Democratic Party from the 1920s till the 1960s. Their father served as Speaker of the Virginia House of Delegates, okay? So this is his ancestry, very, very blue-blooded royal elite family. Okay, and now I just wanted to also talk a little bit about him being a Freemason. It says here his memberships. Byrd was an active Freemason. He was raised. That is, he was given the rank of a Master Mason in Federal Lodge No. 1, Washington, D.C. Now, I don't know what a Master Mason is, but it's obviously not somebody low on the ladder. He is quite high up, okay? 33rd degree, I don't know, but it doesn't say, but, you know, who knows? And I don't even know how the degrees of the Masons work, but he was one of the higher-ranking Masons. He was raised, that is, became a Master Mason in Federal Lodge No. 1, Washington, D.C. on March 19, 1921. And so you see, he was already a Master Mason before any of his alleged expeditions. And affiliated with Cane Lodge, Lodge No. 454, New York City, September 18, 1928. He was a member of National Sojourners Chapter 3 at Washington. In 1930, Byrd was awarded a gold medal by Cane Lodge. These are like gold medals, are like knighthoods that the queen and the kings hand out to their servants that have faithfully furthered the agenda of the empire. And that's what Richard Byrd did. He furthered the agenda of the empire. Lastly, in regards to Operation High Jump, I just wanted to say quickly that this is a movie. There's actually a alleged documentary about it that was made in the 40s called The Secret Land. And I'll put a link to it in the description. You can watch it. But what we read here again about this Operation High Jump is that in 1946, Secretary of the Navy James Forrestal, this is right after the war, okay? A point like, you know, right after the war, you have this major, you know, reconstruction going on. The world is being rebuilt. And what does the Navy do? Appointed a charge of Antarctic developments. Like, you know, don't you think, like, you know, all the destruction that had taken place in Europe and Japan around the world, that, you know, there would have been other priorities at that time instead of Antarctic developments? So people will connect that, you know, oh, the Nazis has gone down there and they had built all these bases and they were just going to come and, you know, destroy the U.S. with their flying craft and their spacecraft and they're this and they're that. And we shall see in this video that follows that all of that is, again, a very, very carefully crafted fiction, okay? It's like reading the National Enquirer or watching a soap opera. People get hooked on it, and they've been hooked on the story of Operation High Jump for so long. Anyways, in 1946, Secretary of the Navy James Forrestal appointed Byrd as officer in charge of Antarctic Developments Project. Byrd's fourth Antarctic expedition was codenamed Operation High Jump. It was the largest Antarctic expedition to date and was expected to last 6 to 8 months. If this was for the purpose of Antarctic developments, how come a few years later they just shut the Antarctic off completely, that there can be no development there? Byrd had come around and said, oh man, this, you know, it's like so rich in all kinds of minerals and resources and this and that, you know, and all these companies are going to be down there in no time, you know, setting up bases like they were going to set up on the moon. Okay, this moon story and the Antarctic story, they're very, very similar. The expedition. So anyhow, so they put together this armada, okay, and it says that it arrived there on December 31st, 1946. Let's say on January 1, 1947, and it was expected to last 6 to 8 months, which should have taken it into June or July or August of 1947. But what do we read here? That Admiral Byrd was interviewed by Lee Van Atta of International News Service aboard the expedition's command ship USS Mount Olympus, in which he discussed the lessons learned. Look at that word there, lessons learned. Have you heard that before again since that time? The lessons learned from the Iraq War, from the Vietnam War, from this, from that. What lessons learned? What lessons did he learn? Okay, so sorry, I forgot to turn my phone off there. So let's look at what it says here about this expedition. So it was supposed to last 6 to 8 months, right? So within like 2 months later, Admiral Byrd is apparently safely aboard his command vessel, which is called the Mount Olympus. And I'm sure there's no significance to Mount Olympus, the name of the ship. All right. Anyhow, you can do your own research as what Olympus was and who these people really serve. Okay. Admiral Byrd was interviewed by Lee Van Atta of International News Service. Now, this is an international news service that is allegedly doing this interview, okay? Aboard the expedition's command ship, USS Mount Olympus, in which he discussed the lessons learned from the operation. The interview appeared in the Wednesday, March 5th, 1947 edition of Chilean newspaper El Mercurio and read in part as follows. Now, this man, this reporter, allegedly is from the International News Service, and this was the largest expedition ever mounted to Antarctica in the history of the world, okay? And we are told that this interview appeared only in the Chilean newspaper El Mercurio and nowhere else. Like, you know, in the International News Service, shouldn't they be broadcasting internationally? And then, you know, remember Richard Byrd being such a big American hero, should that not have been in all the American newspapers first where this should have been published? So, you know, like these kind of questions you need to ask. And what lesson did he learn? Now, we read about that they did down there for these 2 months instead of 6 to 8 months. The Armada arrived in the Ross Sea on December 31st, 1946 and made aerial explorations of an area half the size of the United States, recording 10 new mountain ranges. The major area covered was the eastern coastline of Antarctica from 150 degrees east to the Greenwich Meridian. All right. So this is what they were doing there. allegedly, that they're mapping things out, they're doing exploration. But what is the story that Byrne gives to the paper, allegedly? Okay, Admiral Richard E. Byrne warned today. So this is the lesson that was learned. Okay, not about that. You know, yeah, this is this area we've explored it. It's got these mountain ranges. It's got these other land masses, etc., etc. Because they explored an area half the size of the U.S., which is a substantially big area, right? Nothing. Admiral Richard E. Byrne warned today that the United States should adopt measures of protection against the possibility of an invasion of the country by hostile planes coming from the polar regions. So here begins that myth about the Nazis being down there, about these, you know, aliens being down there. And this myth has been perpetrated ever since, okay? Even like shows like The X-Files. And if you think that there's even like an iota of truth in The X-Files, you know, you are sadly mistaken. X-Files was a total propaganda programming, okay? And that's what this is here. It is propaganda programming that is going on. The Admiral explained that he was not trying to scare anyone. Oh, he's not trying to scare anyone, but he's telling, you know, this is what should be the most top secret information if this was actually true. And he is openly broadcasting it out to the International News Service. He was not trying to scare anyone, but the cruel reality, right, okay, is that in case of a new war, the United States could be attacked by planes flying over one or both poles. Okay, wow. You know, it's obvious to understand that, you know, if they're coming from Russia or something, sure, they can fly over the North Pole, if there is a North Pole, which is another one of those questions that is raised here, okay, that he could, they could do that. There's no, they don't need to, that's nothing new information. They already knew that that could happen with long-range aircraft that had already been developed by that time, right? But what's, but the South Pole, that somebody's going to come from South Poles over the South Pole to attack the U.S.? Come on, man, let's get real here, okay? The statement was made as part of a recapitulation of his own polar experience in an exclusive interview with the International News Service. And this, again, an exclusive interview with the International News Service, and it only allegedly got published in this tiny Chilean newspaper. You know, most people never even probably heard of Chile at that time, right? Yeah, give me a break here. Talking about the recently completed expedition, Byrd said the most important result or the most important lesson learned of his observation and discoveries is the potential effect that they have in relation to the security of the United States. So on the one hand, they tell us, you know, they were out there casually exploring, mapping things out, looking at planes, looking at these mountain ranges, etc., etc. And when it comes time to give an interview, what is he talking about? That, yeah, we got to take care of the security of the United States. Okay, and you shall understand when you watch this video as to how ridiculous these statements really are and that this is all fiction. And, you know, it goes on to tell us here, when you can read between the lines, that this whole operation was a movie production. In 1948, the U.S. Navy produced a documentary about Operation High Jump named The Secret Land. And I'll put a link to that in the description. And this is on the, you can watch this on YouTube even. The film shows live-action footage of the operation. Now, look at this, what follows here. The film shows live-action footage of the operation along with a few reenacted scenes. I would reverse that. I would say the film is mostly reenacted scenes or a movie production with a few shots of this armada allegedly leaving the shoreline, etc., and a few shots of a few ships that may have been real footage. Okay, it's a movie. And that's what this whole story is. It's fiction. People don't think critically when it comes to such information. They just regurgitate it like a, and they repeat it like a parrot and accept everything at face value, not knowing that the elites have been in the business of lying to us for centuries and millennia. Okay? And the first thing when we hear them speak is we should say, okay, what's the lie here? And the answer is everything is a lie. As you can see from the cover poster of this movie, this is made by MGM Hollywood. It's a movie production, right? And again, like on the right side of that map, you see that alien salute, you could say, with a hand with three fingers and a thumb. It's a thumbs up. Okay, we have done a good job here, boys and girls. Let's give ourselves a thumbs up. And you know what? in the defense, so called the alleged defense department, produced like thousands of movies, especially in the 40s, 50s, and 60s. And each and every one of them was propaganda. All of the major movie stars like John Wayne, etc., they were under contract to the Department of Defense. And I would not be surprised if all these modern day actors, they're also under contract one way or the other to these to the elites through either the CIA or any of the Defense Department, the Pentagon, etc. Okay, Hollywood has always been controlled by the elites, and particularly in the United States by the so-called Defense Department. And this is something which most people are not aware of. Okay, so this movie, like all the other thousands of movies that they produce, a lot of them on the so-called nuclear blast, etc., they are all propaganda films. They are designed to program you into believing the lie instead of the truth. Okay, and one of the lies that is perpetrated here is that Antarctica is a real continent. Okay, or that we live in a spinning globe which has poles. That is the subliminal message that is presented through these alleged expeditions and the movies that they're made based on them. Yes, I believe in flat Earth. And if that is something that puts you off, then you can stop watching this video. But if you want to learn more about how you are programmed into a lie constantly, and this goes back thousands of years, nothing new under the sun, then you should keep watching. Hello and welcome. This is Paul Sandu. I wanted to do a video. Actually, I've been wanting to do this for a while. Okay, since I have heard this information on and off for many years about Admiral Byrd and his various expeditions to the North Pole, South Pole, to the Hollow Earth inside, and all those kind of stories, which have made this man like almost a mythical figure. Okay, in the annals of explorers, he is considered by many to be on the level of a Columbus, Christopher Columbus, or Magellan, or one of those guys, Anyways, so the purpose of doing this is to understand what is the reality and what is the fiction. What is the truth? And right off the bat, I will say that what I'm going to tell you is my conjecture. Having studied conspiracies, alternative history, which is like real history, and such subjects for a very long time, like over 20 years now, I have come to, the older I get, the more I learn, the greater this realization I come to, that nothing is as it seems. Okay, we truly do live in the Matrix. And the Matrix is far more pervasive. In that movie where Lawrence Fishburne, he's talking to Neo, and he tells him, yeah, the Matrix is everywhere. It's even in this room. It's when you pay your taxes. It's when you go to church. When you go to vote. Anywhere, it doesn't matter. The Matrix is everywhere. And that is the truth. The Matrix is everywhere. And what is the Matrix? The Matrix is more or less a movie production. Okay? It is like having glasses on your eyes, which are like virtual reality glasses. So whatever you are seeing, it may seem very real, but in reality it is not. And that's how most of the people live. When we are born, these glasses are put on our eyes right away. Okay? You could say that we even are born with these glasses on, these virtual reality glasses on. But there are entities and peoples that are involved in producing a movie for you to watch that'll be played on these glasses. So what I want to talk today about is the story of Admiral Richard E. Byrd, his legendary expeditions, and to determine how much of it is fact as opposed to how much of it is fiction. I would have to conclude that it is almost 100% fiction, so let's get to the end of the story right away. But that's my conclusion, and here's why. Yeah, I'll begin by playing a video. Okay, I'll put a link to this video. You can watch it on YouTube,
And there are many videos like this about Operation High Jump and Admiral Byrd and what went down in Antarctica. Stories about the Nazis, UFOs, aliens, the whole mythos, which has been really played upon for the past 70 years now or so. And even like programs like The X-Files, they really pushed this envelope of Antarctica and the aliens agenda. Okay. So here's this video, and then I will give my analysis based on the information that is being presented here.
Admiral, you speak of the resources of Antarctica. What are they? What are the natural resources there?
Well, we've found enough of coal within 180 miles of the South Pole in a great ridge of mountains that's not covered with snow, enough to supply the whole world for quite a while.
Well,
that's the coal. Now, there's evidence of many other minerals. We are pretty sure there's oil. Now, that coal shows the bottom of the world. Now, by far, the coldest spot in the world. Where that coal is gets 100 below zero in the winter.
Well,
it was once tropical. So we think there's oil there, and there's evidence, probably uranium there.
Are there that many expeditions now there or en route there?
As I said, it's the most peaceful place in the world, but I don't think it will be for long. Because of this intense interest on the part of other nations and this nation.
Our distinguished guest was Admiral Richard E. Byrd.
So the longer version of this interview with Admiral Byrd is available on YouTube, and you can just Google it, and you will be able to watch it. However, now I just want to basically dissect what this great explorer had to say and see if the information he is presenting actually confirmed by some known facts. So as you look at some of these pictures from Antarctica that can be found online, I'm just going to read about what the weather of Antarctica is like. First of all, Antarctica, they say, is a continent which is about double the size of Australia, but it is also the mainland of Antarctica is covered with a sheet of ice, which is roughly 2 kilometers thick. Okay, so it's over 6,000 feet thick ice covers the whole continent. They say that if this ice was to melt, that the sea levels across the world would rise by 200 feet. Okay, so that's how much ice it contains. 90% of the ice in the world is in Antarctica. So these are some facts that we are told by various people, okay, and various organizations like NASA. So here's from weatheronline.co.uk. It tells us Antarctica is the coldest continent on Earth and has a climate of extremes. The continent is snow and ice covered with freezing temperatures all year round, so it never goes above freezing. So-called Katabian, C-A-T-A-B-I-A-N, Katabian winds can cause violent snowstorms that can last for days and sometimes even weeks. Okay. Making it very dangerous to stay outside. Antarctica knows periods of sunlight and daylight and darkness called polar summer, which is from May to September, and polar winter from end November to March. The polar summer with daytime temperatures between minus 20 and minus 5 degrees Celsius is the only time to travel to Antarctica because the conditions are too severe during the winter months with extreme cold temperatures, violent storms, darkness, an ice-bound sea. Note, be prepared for extreme weather conditions at any time. The weather can change very quickly in Antarctica. Sunshine can change to a serious snowstorm from one moment to the other. This picture that you're looking at, it is, if it is from the Antarctic, because a lot of these pictures, when you Google them, they are actually not from the Antarctic. They are from the Arctic, or they are from Greenland, or, northern Yukon in Canada, or in for Russia. But anyhow, let's say that it is from the Antarctic. Then this picture is not from the mainland, okay? It is from the far northern, closer to South America, peninsular islands, which people visit. What I'm trying to highlight here is that the reality of Antarctica, its geography, its climate, etc., is quite different than what people have in their minds, you know, with cute little penguins floating around and little ice floes and all that kind of stuff. Okay, I'm going to play a little video for you here, okay, which is going to be, I think, a shock for most people. And my hat's off to these guys who are doing this stuff. You know, you guys are crazy. But this will give you an idea of what you're dealing with once you get away from these islands that surround this ice wall, and you start moving inwards where these mountains are that Richard Byrd said, you know, contains a lot of coal, oil, uranium, and all that kind of stuff.
This is one of the most challenging environments for a climber you can visit anywhere on planet Earth. It'll be spicy for sure. We're heading out on a ski tour to circumnavigate one range of peaks. Survey the peaks from different angles and kind of come up with an action plan of different lines we want to try to climb, different mountains we want to explore further.
I'm just holding it and then just bam, it'll go down.
Well, okay.
In watching Mike take off, as soon as the wind picked up his canopy and he shot out of there like a slingshot, immediately we realized this was a terrible idea. So we strapped our skins back on and just started trekking. As the sun was setting, this really heavy storm kicked in.
I just want to draw certain facts that we can learn from this video of these guys going up mountain climbing in Antarctica. Okay, first of all, the distance. Okay, they take off from Johannesburg, South Africa, and this flight that they take to get to the what you might call the mainland, okay, was about 12, 14 hours. It was a long flight. And then from there, they had to jump on another plane to go into the interior where these mountains are. So these mountains are nowhere near the coastline, okay? They are quite far inland. That is one fact. Second fact is that these conditions that you will see in this video are very extreme. But this is during their summer months, which are the best months of the year. This will be like in February, March, around there, which are the best months to go down there. Okay. And I can't even imagine how bad it gets during the winter months, which are there, you know, July, August, September, somewhere in there. But this will be the winter time down there.
Immediately, we had to start working together as a team, digging in hard and fast. The only thing we could find was this really tiny boulder that we could take shelter behind.
We've got about 3 foot drift in our vestibule, the front door of our tent that I had to dig out. The wind's super high and we're just trying to deal the head down suffer fest. Trying to survive more than anything else right now.
I'm looking for a route that'll reveal itself, and hopefully we can connect some lines and find something and go climbing.
Day 3 of our ski tour, just getting ready to go crush and see what's around the corner on this huge, massive blue ice plateau. It's like being on the coast of a frozen ocean.
We were all shocked to stumble upon this Indian capsule out in the middle of nowhere.
You can see this survival shelter, or this living unit, was just bowled over by 150 mile an hour winds. Who knows, maybe stronger. Definitely makes you feel a little bit vulnerable. Fragile human out here. We could just be taken out at any time, no doubt about it.
the weather here, it's raw and it's brutal, and it just beats the shit out of you.
...150-mile-an-hour wind speeds are like, that's like a Category 4 hurricane, okay? And this is not uncommon there. Like, this weather is this is the weather down there, year-long. And it can spring up any time. So that, you know, you have like a 2-3 months of just calm and weather where you can just go exploring. It is not reality. The reality is that it's like when you go climbing in Everest. You know, there's if you want to see the movie Everest, it's quite an intense movie. But in it, you learn that, you know, the window, that the weather is it can change on a dime, so that the window of opportunity to do much of mountain climbing up on Everest, as it would be in the case here in Antarctica, is very, very limited. So that means that also the window of opportunity for exploration is also very, very limited.
After that recon to look for routes getting back to our camp, it was ravaged. The katabatic winds had come in and just had its way with our camp and destroyed it. A couple of the tents that we'd left set up were completely covered by spindrift snow. Poles broken, tents collapsed. Without us there to maintain it, it was destroyed.
The crazy thing is it hasn't snowed an inch since we've been here. That's all wind-driven snow. So,
savage, dude.
Pretty savage.
Technically, Antarctica is a desert because it doesn't get much precipitation. However, that doesn't mean the snowdrifts, and massive snowdrifts at that, are not a problem there. They are a very, very big problem. And one of the things I've noticed is when you do Google search on Antarctica bases, etc., that most of those photos are fake, that they are photos of bases in the Arctic or in the Greenland or somewhere in upper northern Canada, you know, in the Yukon or Northwest Territories or somewhere around there. Because one thing you will notice in the in those pictures is the structures that would not be able to handle this massive, you know, snowdrifts and snowstorms and massive winds that spring up. And secondly, you'll also notice in those pictures is a distinct lack of snow clearing equipment. The point is that the majority of pictures that you will see online that are purportedly from Antarctica, and some of them even show polar bears, you know, just ridiculous things like wolves. Anyhow, they are not from Antarctica. They are mostly from the Arctic regions. And they are placed there deliberately to try and fool you that what you're looking at is Antarctica. Most of the real pictures of Antarctica, like I said, are of the outer islands. And I would also venture to think that most of the so-called Antarctic bases, they are located either on these peninsular islands, or if they are actually on what would be considered to be the mainland, they are very close to the coast. They are not inland at all.
Look at this. This is hard. Fucked.
Real deal, man. Antarctica.
Yes, the link is in the description. So you can watch it. These videos, they are quite interesting because they show us the reality of what's on the ground up or down there as opposed to what we have been led to believe.
Admiral, you speak of the resources of Antarctica. What are they? What are the natural resources there?
Well, we've found enough of coal within 180 miles of the South Pole in a great ridge of mountains that's not covered with snow, enough to supply the whole world for quite a while.
Well,
that's the coal. Now, there's evidence of many other minerals. We are pretty sure there's oil. Now, that coal shows the bottom of the world. Now, by far, the coldest spot in the world. Where that coal is gets 100 below zero in the winter.
Now, the good admiral is telling us that about all these wonderful resources that are in Antarctica. So, now you've seen the harsh conditions that exist down there and the great distances that have to be covered. Okay, even with modern machines, like modern planes, modern equipment, it is very, very difficult and very dangerous to get down there. Now, the question is that how did Admiral Byrd, in back in those days when planes had much shorter ranges, the ships were not as reliable as they are today, and how was he able to explore this whole vast continent, as they call it? Explored it enough to discover that there was enough coal to supply the whole world. Okay, and then by his own admission, he goes on to say that it's the temperature there goes to 100 below zero. Okay. So does this place have any kind of value whatsoever as a resource to supply resources? Just think of the difficulty or the near impossibility of actually being able to mine. Let's say there coal is there to be able to mine it, or there's oil is there to be able to extract it, or if there's uranium there, yeah, maybe okay, uranium you may be able to want to, because it has enough, it can you know, value that it can be commercial value, that it can be worthwhile. But just think, trying to, and he said this is within 180 miles to the South Pole. And how far is the South Pole already inland? To get that from there back to the coast, down the 6,000 feet cliffs and into the oceans, and then to bring it over and supply it, makes no sense. So this story that, you know, that it has some sort of value as because it has a lot of resources, this to me sounds like a big smokescreen that, you know what? First of all, it is doubtful that they were able to explore it to that extent. And secondly, given the conditions that exist down there, and secondly, even if these resources that do exist, you know, they are not going to be, they might as well be on in another galaxy or something, for the difficulty that and the cost that it will be to extract them and to bring them to market. Now, the story of Operation High Jump and Admiral Richard E. Byrd, it gets even more bizarre. Again, this I'm just concentrating on his Antarctic explorations, or his alleged Antarctic explorations, not even what we have read about him being at the North Pole and inside the Earth and all that. So here, let's continue watching this video.
Well, it was once tropical. So we think there's oil there, and there's evidence, probably uranium there.
Are there that many expeditions now there or en route there?
Well, you know, as I said, it's the most peaceful place in the world, but I don't think it will be for long because of this intense interest on the part of other nations and this nation.
Our distinguished guest was Admiral Richard E. Byrd.
Okay, the problem, in my opinion, is that most people buy information coming from sources such as Admiral Byrd without any applying any sort of critical thinking to what they are saying. One thing people do not realize, that the science of propaganda was perfected very much so during the early years of the 20th century, from the 19, I would say even from the very early part, from the First World War on especially, and through the end of the Second World War, it had been pretty much perfected by the Brits, by the Germans, and by the Americans, all of whom worked together. And this is one of the major functions of the defense industry, so-called defense industry, defense department, was propaganda movie productions. And they had actors that were employed to go out there and spread the fictions that the defense department wanted to spread, such as Roswell, okay, in 1947. Complete fiction, completely scripted. And this here interview with Richard Byrd and all his interviews and his secret diaries and all that such, it is all scripted Hollywood Hollywood fiction. And in this interview, what he is saying is, if you listen closely, he is promoting certain memes which have been absolutely scripted. And this interview is not impromptu. It is not, you know, something that you would expect honest answers in. What he says is that, you know, he, in the early part of the interview, if you can go back to online, you can listen to the whole thing. He talks about the North Pole and the South Pole. So he is reinforcing the globe meme, that the world is a globe, that the Earth is a globe, okay? That he's been to the North Pole and now he's been to the South Pole, both of which are a lie. On a flat Earth, we don't have a North Pole and we don't have a South Pole. What we have is the center of the Earth, and we have the ends of the Earth, okay? The center of the Earth could be called the North Pole, and the ends of the Earth would be Antarctica, okay? Then he goes on to promote other fictions, such as that of evolution, such as that of, you know, dinosaurs, fossil fuels, etc. What does he tell us? Oh, Antarctica was once a tropical paradise. No, it was not, Okay, there's nothing in history to suggest there are no trees there. There is no animal life there. There is nothing. It is a barren. It is basically a world of ice. That's what it is. It's an icy world. We don't even know if there is any land underneath it or not, but there may be. But it is definitely all it is a wall of ice. Okay, and therefore this idea that it was a tropical is it is all another fiction. Then he promotes the idea of fossil fuels. Oh yeah, it was tropical, so there's oil there. Okay, he doesn't say that he found oil there. He's just speculating. Okay, and most people think that oh yeah, there's oil there. And as I said just recently, and just in the previous a few minutes ago, is that you know, even if there is, so what? How are you going to extract it and bring it to market? The cost would be prohibited. Prohibitive. The technology employed to extract it would be prohibitive. Can you go through 2 miles of ice to extract oil? Come on, man. Give me a break, will you? Okay. It's a ridiculous idea. So he is promoting this idea that Antarctica is just like any other place on Earth. It is not. It is completely different. Even compared to the Arctic, it is an entirely different world down there. Okay. And this was the mission of this man. Was to go out there and spread this false information. He talks about uranium. He talks about, you know, the governments are interested. So before you know it, everybody's going to be making a beeline down there. You'll have like, you know, Exxon, Mobil, you know, Royal Dutch Shell. You watch it, you know, all these companies are going to be down there. They're going to be extracting all this oil and all this. Well, none of that stuff happened, right? This interview is from like 60 years ago. How many people are down there at any given time? The estimate, you know, there are like between 500 and maybe a couple thousand people in that whole Antarctic region at any given time. Okay. And those numbers even are suspect. And they have all these big research stations and all that, which is just another hoax, in my opinion. All these guys, they go down there, they sit around for 6 months and then they come home. They might take some air temperatures and all that. And that's about all that happens down there because this is the most inhospitable place on the face of the earth. It is the most extreme climates. Nothing can survive down there, and nothing is feasible in far as, you know, creating any kind of industries or mining or anything sort of thing. So this whole interview with Richard Byrd was a complete hoax, okay? And now let's talk about Operation High Jump. While I'm on the topic, I just want to mention one thing. I want to compare his missions to the moon missions, okay? Most people who are especially now believers in Flat Earth, they understand that the moon missions were a hoax. And those interviews with, Neil Armstrong and all the other guys were a complete joke. But at the same time, the very same people, they buy everything that Richard Byrd is saying as gospel truth. You know, no, he's just an early version of Neil Armstrong. In all these interviews and all his missions, they also were a hoax. And all these interviews are just as fake as those of Neil Armstrong and the other guys. Yeah, before I go to Operation High Jump, I just wanted to point out that, in this clip that with Richard Byrd here, like he's got a big smirk on his face as he's answering. He has to put the hand across his face because he is laughing. He's laughing because he knows everything he's saying is BS, and he is essentially laughing at the stupid listeners who are going to listen to this stuff and, swallow it hook, line, and sinker without any question whatsoever. Okay, now let's just jump through the hoops a little bit and talk a little bit about Operation High Jump. Okay, let me just say this about Operation High Jump to begin with. Every year, the U.S. Navy, any of the services of the, defense services like the Air Force or the military, they conduct thousands of operations. Ask yourself, how many is it that you really see about? How many of them are shown on television? How many of them are movies produced and readily available on YouTube about? Okay. Point here is that the business of the defense industry, the Navy, the Marines, the Air Force, etc., what they do and the operations they run, they are very closely guarded secrets. They are not advertised. In contrast, this Operation High Jump, I would have to say that this has to be one of the most unadvertised operations in the history of the Defense Department. Everybody is, this dog has heard about Operation High Jump. Movies have been made about it. Stories have been read. Books have been written about it. Okay? Yet, there are probably less books about, you know, what went on at Dunkirk or something in the Second World War than there are about High Jump on YouTube right now. Why? Why? Again, I want to draw a parallel between this and Roswell, because it's a psyop. Right from the beginning, the whole career of Richard Byrd was, by the way, a psyop. I'll do another video separately about talking about who this man was and what it turns out to, that this was a blue-blooded, like, insider establishment boy, if there ever was one. His lineage goes right back down to the early Canolian days, and he comes, you know, somebody in his family was actually married to Pocahontas. I mean, the man was an East Coast establishment boy who was made an admiral by a decree of Congress. He was not like one of these guys that rises up in the ranks and he's a career Navy man. He was not. And you know what? I mean, if they did want to mount this invasion of Antarctica, as these Operation High Jump stories go, and I'll play a couple of clips here for you, with beautiful music, you know, sounds exactly like a Hollywood movie, and my friends, that's what it is. It's a Hollywood movie. And therefore, instead of, you know, getting one of their battle-hardened admirals in there to lead the fleet, they recommission Admiral Byrd and send him down there. With like movie crews, with you know, him giving interviews in Chile, with like coded, you know, terminology. Oh, there's going to be a new enemy who's going to be coming from the poles. Ooh, be afraid, be very afraid. The Nazis are down there. All garbage stories, okay? Now let's see what is Operation High Jump. What kind of information is out there and how many people are spreading it? You know, you can hear stories about this on Coast to Coast and just about every alternative conspiracy guy, you know, they're spreading the same story. And what I have discovered is the more it's out there, the more likely it is that this is all fake. And I'm 100% convinced that this whole story is a fake, like Richard Byrd's career right from beginning to end. Doesn't this wonderful music make your heart pounding, set your heart pounding? You know, doesn't it get you excited that you're discovering such wonderful information, secret information, which is readily available on YouTube? The story of Operation High Jump is that Richard E. Byrd went down to Antarctica with an expedition of 4,000 men and a military expedition, and the purpose of it was to fight these Nazis who had fled down there, and they had somehow, the first expedition that we record about the Nazis going down to Antarctica was in 1938-39. So while the war was raging, in those 6 or 7 years, like, you know, 1947, so like 8 or 9 years, they managed to dig down into two miles of ice, and they built these massive underground bases with, like, all this fantastic, you know, weaponry and these sausage-shaped craft as well, but you know, these disc-shaped crafts that can fly from pole to pole in like incredible speeds, as Admiral Byrd said. So, you know, and they managed to destroy Richard Byrd's expedition within a matter of 2 weeks, and he you know, put his tail between his legs and he headed straight back. That's the story of Operation High Jump. Now, ask yourself this question. If they could build that much in a matter of 8 or 9 years, these incredible bases underground, you know, with this fantastic machinery, these fantastic weapons and flying crafts, how much do you think they might have built in the preceding, in the 75 years or so that have now gone by since the end of Second World War, okay? Where are these Nazis? Why haven't they come out of there and conquered the world with these amazing machines that destroyed, that destroyed Richard Byrd's expedition in a matter of 2 weeks when it was supposed to last 8 months? Okay, so there's this very famous interview which Admiral Richard E. Byrd gave in Chile after he, ran from Antarctica 2 weeks after his expedition started, because they apparently lost a lot of planes, There were people that were shooting them down, and all these airmen were being lost. Wow. So it turns out that, he was no John Wayne. He didn't destroy the big bad Nazis. He just turned tail and ran. So he ends up in Chile, and in Chile he gives an interview with this newspaper called The Mercury. Okay, and this interview is quoted, verbatim, like ad infinitum. Okay, Admiral Byrd gave this interview in which he said the enemy was going to come from the poles, and they're going to have these planes, these craft which are going to fly like from pole to pole at incredible speeds, and the U.S. has to prepare for war with them. These are the bad Nazis, That's the story. All right, so the newspaper that it appeared in was Mercury. And who is Mercury? Okay, Mercury is a major Roman god, being one of the Dies Consentes within the ancient Roman pantheon. He is a patron god of financial gain, commerce, eloquence, and thus poetry, messages, communication, including divination, travelers, boundaries, luck, trickery, and thieves. He is also the guide of souls to the underworld. Okay? Yeah, so this story appears in the newspaper titled The Mercury, which, as I just read to you, it gives you messages, communications, divination from the spirit world. So these are coded messages that were given by Admiral Byrd if this interview ever actually took place. And let's just see what he said, and then I will tell you how ridiculous this whole idea is, that anybody from the Defense Department who was in such a situation, if this was real, would ever give such an interview. All right, so let's just read this information that is being presented in this video, which has been, like I said, repeated infinite ad infinitum, and all kinds of programs like Coast to Coast, Jeff Rentz, and you name it, any of these alternative media places, like anything to do with UFOs, anything to do with the Nazis and all that such, this is out there and has been for a long time. So this is what this person in the video is saying. Many authors propose that in 46-47, Admiral Byrd, one of the most famous American polar explorers, searched for secret Nazi bases. Interestingly, many people believe Admiral Byrd made a number of cryptic comments while he was interviewed by the International News Service correspondent aboard the USS Mount Olympus. The article appeared in the 5th March 1947 edition of Chilean newspaper El Mercurio. Admiral Byrd declared today that it was imperative for the United States to initiate immediate defense measures against hostile regions. The Admiral further stated that he didn't want to frighten anyone unduly. Oh, he didn't. But that it was a bitter reality that in the case of a new war, the continental United States would be attacked by flying objects which could fly from pole to pole at incredible speeds. Admiral Byrd repeated the above points of view resulting from his personal knowledge gathered both at the North and South Poles before a news conference with the International News Service. Okay? So that's where he did. So I had it on pause, so let's look at this here. Admiral Byrd repeated the above points of view resulting from his personal knowledge gathered both at the North and South Poles before a news conference held for International News Service. Now, isn't that interesting that an admiral of the United States Navy who has suddenly encountered this incredible enemy that the world has never seen before with technologies. Yes, they have seen the Nazis, but they haven't seen this type of technology that apparently the good admiral encountered down there, which made him, you know, like I said, put his tail between his legs and run. And he comes out there, and he first thing he does, he announces this information to the whole world. That makes a whole lot of sense, doesn't it? Before you go back home, before you have your debriefings, before, you know, like you talk to the president or whatever and give them this information that this is what is going on down there, you talk to the International News Service and you tell them, listen, don't be alarmed, don't be afraid, but, you know, there's this new enemy. Like, you know, they got these incredible craft that can move from pole to pole at incredible speeds. And they're going to attack the continental United States. But don't be alarmed. Please don't be alarmed. This is nothing. Everything is under control. Yeah. This is what they do. Of course, this does not happen in real life. Of course, if this was any bit of a reality, first of all, you would have never heard of Operation High Jump. And secondly, if there were Nazis down there and they did have, or whatever, aliens or anything, and they had these incredible technologies down there, the first place that this good admiral would have made a beeline for would have been Washington, D.C. And this information would have been buried so deep. It would have been so classified that, you know, 50 generations from now, you would have not heard a word about it. What is this? This is a psyop. It's fakery. It's like information being put out there for your consumption, and people just swallow it. Hook, line, and sinker. Admiral Byrd said it, so it's all true. None of this stuff is true. What is the information in here that he's telling you? The real quote here is, his personal knowledge gathered both at the North and South Poles. So he is promoting again that globe agenda that we are living on this ball, which has a North Pole and a South Pole. I visited both of them, and, you know, this is, I've encountered these incredible creatures there. And, you know, we are in a world of trouble now because the continental United States is going to get attacked. Did any of that stuff happen, my friends? Of course it didn't, because it's all BS. Okay, now as you watch this next clip, pay close attention once again to the dramatic music and this imagery that's in there of these fantastic buildings and all this underground construction that apparently happened within a matter of like some 5-6 years in the middle of the war in Antarctica by these superhuman Nazis, okay? But secondly, right at the beginning of this clip, it tells you something that Admiral Byrd, okay, when the Nazis went down to Antarctica first time, apparently in 1938-39, who did they consult with? Well, Richard Byrd of all people. So again, these connections, as with the bankers during the war, in America, in England, in Switzerland, in Germany, they all were linked with each other, they were communicating with each other. They were buying, selling, trading with each other right in the midst of the war, and all before the war, through the war, and after the war. Okay, same thing with these militaries, okay? They were in cahoots with each other well before the war began, in the middle of the war, and after the war. So this mythos of this big bad Nazi down in Antarctica doing these crazy things was already being manufactured well before Operation High Jump. Now, here's another fake picture if you ever saw one. First of all, even in the middle of the Antarctic summer, okay, temperatures go down to something like 15, 20 below Celsius, okay? You wouldn't, and if you guys have not lived in the north, you don't know how cold that is, okay? Like, these guys would not be walking around in their shirt sleeves. And secondly, if you look at these lines here, okay, how this picture curves, see how these nice straight curves, straight lines, which would not occur naturally. So this is a composite. This picture is a Photoshop picture, okay? And what is the need for all these Photoshop pictures? And these probably not even from 1945. This is probably just like taken somewhere recently. All right. So again, people don't pay any kind of critical analysis of what they see, and they buy it. Like I said, hook, line, and sinker. Now, when you look at this drawing of this incredible, you know, like alien kind of base that they're showing here, I mean, of course, this is all like drawings. And as CGI, none of this is real. Yet people believe that you know, the Nazis, in a matter of 4 or 5 years, they went down there, they dug deep 2 miles under the ice, and they built these fantastic bases with these submarine channels, and you know, with these flying saucers, and they can just basically obliterate the whole world in a matter of minutes. Man, if they could, where are they? What the heck are they still doing down there 75 years later? Why haven't they come up to the surface and built these across the world? Why have they not conquered the world, which was their dream? Right? The thousand-year Reich. What happened to it? Do you understand that these stories were being manufactured well before the 40s? And then as we get into the 50s, into the 40s with Roswell, which happened at the same time, 1947, as Operation High Jump. And, you know, then we get into Area 51. Then with this alternative 3 theory, you know, that all the top scientists have gone missing and such, and they've been taken to Mars, and they've been going to the moon and such. All of this stuff is Hollywood fiction, just like the images that you're looking at the screen. They are not real. Now, the story that is being told in this video, it seems like an episode of The X-Files. And, of course, The X-Files is big in Antarctica as well, pushing that meme, you know, that there's bases down there and there's aliens down there. Just garbage. Okay, and this guy and this story, Strange Days, whichever this channel is, you know, they're promoting the story that, you know, so a couple of British guys went down there, they found this place, and they were underground, you know, and then they blew up the tunnels to the entrance to this thing here, you know, two superheroes, and then they came back and they were silenced, and, you know, nobody knows anything about this. Well, my friends, if this such kind of secrets did actually exist, I can tell you for sure certainty that most of the spooks inside this MI6 and inside the CIA, they would not know about it, okay? Let alone being this information being made available to any kind of geek out on YouTube would not happen. All this is just another manufactured Hollywood story. These people, they put these stories out there. And this is an intelligence operation. They put these stories out there, and then they let the idiots run with it. And then the mythos grows, and people like Steve Quayle and all these other guys, you know, they run around repeating this same story and embellishing it. And before you know it, there's a whole army of fools that believe this garbage, and they spread it more and more. And again, as you watch this video, keep in mind, you know, this is a professionally made video. It is not somebody, you know, just an amateur that has done this year. So who are the people that make these things? And who are they that spread this around? In The X-Files, there was a character who was a real man in black. And one of his jobs was to plant fake stories, like with these aliens and UFOs and everything in everywhere, from the New York Times to the National Enquirer. Okay, and that's exactly, there are whole departments that are dedicated to this, to manufacturing these stories, and we are not talking about this happening now. This was started back in the early 20th century, maybe even earlier, but especially in the 20th century, between the second, after this First World War, they had active departments, both in movie making and in the print media, that was out there spreading fake stories. Nothing new under the sun. And this Operation High Jump, Richard Byrd's story, is one of those movies that you've been watching, it's time to understand that this is fiction and not reality. Now, if such an operation as Operation High Jump did actually in fact take place, it would have been so classified that most of the sailors and the military men themselves would not have been made aware of it until they were well on their way down there. They wouldn't have been sent off with these marching bands and, you know, announcements made that this is what we are doing. Okay, especially if the threat was real, this would have been a highly, highly classified operation, and not just like, you know, one aircraft carrier. I believe they would have thrown the whole Navy at it because it would have been that significant. And then as this researcher or so-called researcher, the conclusion he's drawing here, oh, they went down to recover this lost technology. Really? Okay. What happened to this technology? Where is it? Who's using it? And the people that have it, who had it in the 1940s, what kind of technology do you think they might have today? Why are they still in hiding down there? Does that any of that make sense to you? The Nazis wanted to rule the world. They wanted the Fourth Reich, the Fifth Reich, the Reich that would last 1,000 years. Don't you think now they would be capable of coming out and just taking over the whole world, and everybody would be marching in goose step, in their jackboots already? But none of that stuff has happened, and it will not happen because all of this is fiction.
After a few days, however, and the loss of an undisclosed number of aircraft, the operation was abruptly terminated. What happened? What mysterious opponent could have repelled the Allied invasion so quickly and decisively? Could it have been the few remaining members of the German armed forces?
Again, in a very professional manner, with this guy with this real documentary voice, you know, telling you, could it have been the remainder of the German forces that were down there? They are just keep building this myth of Nazis in Antarctica, Nazis on the moon. Nazis are everywhere. But the reality is that after the war, the Nazis went to Washington, D.C. They went to European countries, like even in London. They went to South Africa, they went to Australia, they went to Argentina, they went to Chile, they went to Paraguay, to Uruguay, all over South America, to Canada. That's where they went. They didn't go down to Antarctica. I mean, they're not that crazy. They took over Washington, D.C. Or they already had it in their control, I would say. If you really understand who the Nazis were. So here, an alternate reality is being created for you. Okay, you live in the Matrix. And this is another one of those Matrix stories which most people don't comprehend. There's nothing real here, folks. Really, there's nothing to see. Move on already. Stop repeating those lies over and over and over and over again. Put your thinking caps on and do some critical thinking. That's what we need to do. Okay? That this man's sole purpose and agenda was to reinforce the mythos of the globe. There's the top of the world, there's the bottom of the world. There's the North Pole and I've been there, there's the South Pole and I've been there. There's this continent of Antarctica which is bigger than the United States down there. Oh yeah, let's go explore it. And there's beautiful lakes there. Let's go and live there. None of that stuff is true. Antarctica is nothing but ice. Nobody lives down there and nobody can live down there. That is my conclusion. You can agree with it or not. That is entirely up to you. I'm going to finish off here and I'm just going to let the clip play to the end. And hey, you may agree with me. I'm sure a lot more people would disagree with me than they agree with me. But that's okay. I still like to use my own mind and come to my own conclusions. Thank you for listening. This is Paul Sandu.
It is clear that under the structures of ice, there are many layers of civilization, suggesting at one earlier point of time, when the conditions of the South Pole were different, clearly there was some type of civilization there. This, of course, is assuming that the shell of the Earth had a different north and south magnetic pole. And with the shifting of the pole, this region became suddenly very, very frigid. and thus we do not see any evidences on the surface of these so-called earlier conditions of intelligence. However, I believe with the further exploration of the documents that both Admiral Byrd brought to the attention of the world after World War II, and the Brazilian Navy uncovered in 1961 with its subpole expedition, that extraterrestrial intelligence is also operated out of the area of the South Pole.
Okay, let's pick up the scenario. We were originally talking about the spiriting out of the two spacecraft out of Berlin before the Allies arrived. We said that they were put aboard two submarines. They spent 6 months at sea, and they finally landed in Argentina. Now, from that point, they were taken into Antarctica, into a section of Antarctica called Queen's Maud's Land. And there they disappeared, and they were not heard of for some time. Now, intelligence sources, and of course I was in the intelligence business at that time with the agency, reports indicated that they were in there and they were operative once again. Now, there was a major concern by world powers to go in and capture the technology and the two spacecraft which they knew were in Antarctica. And the intelligence reports indicated that one known as Admiral Byrd was to be recommissioned, and he was to be sent in there to retrieve the two saucers and also the technology and personnel associated with it. Later reports indicated that Admiral Byrd was given 8 months and unlimited funding to go in and pull this thing successfully off. But we also know that within 8 weeks he was totally defeated.
What do we know about Operation Hijack, about Admiral Byrd's expedition in the autumn of 46, the early spring of 47, to the South Pole? This is an expedition that has been almost forgotten, and it's very hard to come up with any information about it. The few articles that were published at that time in, let's say, National Geographic magazine, would not give any clue to the real intention of that expedition. However, recently we discovered a unique documentary film in color, 1 hour long, made by the U.S. Navy. It was a massive naval operation that involved an aircraft carrier, several battleships, an armed submarine, and probably another 20 supply and battleships. It involved 4,000 troops, U.S. troops, and the rumor is that there were also British and Russian contingents within these 4,000 troops. It was a massive naval operation. It was not as it has been presented to the public, that it was a peaceful expedition to explore the natural resources of the South Pole. They descended to Little America, which is the place of the previous Admiral Byrd landings on the South Pole. And then they started a massive overflight over the whole area of the South Pole, trying to locate the German base that was established there almost 10 years earlier. The Germans started somewhere in 1936-37, seriously exploring the South Pole, and by the time the war ended, the rumor is that they have established a massive underground colony with at least 100,000 scientists, researchers, elite SS.
I have to interject here and to lay to rest this ridiculous idea about the German bases in Antarctica, like this guy saying that they built a base with 100,000 people, okay, in the ice of Antarctica. If the Germans had had that type of technology and that type of spacecraft, like they call it, at their disposal, I can assure you they would not have lost that war, okay? And secondly, we know that the German scientists, they moved to the United States and started NASA. that the German elites that moved to the United States and they started the CIA, okay? They went to work in universities in Russia, in England, all over the world. They went to South America. They didn't go down to Antarctica. This is just a nonsense story that just keeps repeated all the time, and it drives me crazy now.
Troops, children from Hitlerjugend, young boys and girls that were to become the seed of this new and colony that was to be built under the principles of the super race selection. What was it that Admiral Byrd found on the South Pole? Incredibly enough, in an official American Navy documentary film, we found footage of what Admiral Byrd found on the South Pole. He found giant freshwater, never freezing lakes with areas around them that were free of any snow. And in that film, we show footage of the Navy planes landing in these lakes. But even more so, he found, to his amazement, that his planes were disappearing very quickly. A lot of his planes were attacked by anti-gravity devices that were operated by the Germans there, by anti-gravity saucers. A lot of them crashed into invisible barriers and disintegrated in mid-flight. This is an indication that the Germans had already perfected the force field shields, and they were up and operational around the German colony at Neuschwabenland. When he was retreating, basically the whole operation lasted for 1 week. They started at the end of February 47, and by the first week of March, they were through with the whole operation, and much, much earlier than scheduled, and they departed. And in an interview at Buenos Aires on his way back, Admiral Byrd made the incredible statement that the Third World War would probably be with an adversary coming from the polar regions of our planet, an adversary that has the ability to fly unobstructed from pole to pole. He was referring to the Germans at their south polar colony at Neuschwabenland that were operating their anti-gravity craft with impunity and could fly circles around the globe, and of course would shoot out of the sky any of the attacking American planes.
Even at the expense of beating a dead horse, listen to this guy here. He is what you might call very kindly a moron, okay? If the Germans had the kind of technology that he's talking about, he's got these force fields like you hear in Star Trek or in Star Wars, you know, these discs that can circle the globe in like an hour or something like that, like he's talking about. Like he can blow, like, you know, Admiral Byrd's fleet out of the water. Now the question is, why didn't they do so? Why didn't they come like in a goose stepping out of the Antarctic, march up South America unto Washington, take over the Americas and the whole world? What stopped them with that sort of technology at their disposal and hundreds of thousands of people living down there? Do you see how these stories, which are stories, fiction, tales, tall tales, psyops, manufactured somewhere in the bowels of the intelligence agencies in Washington or in London or somewhere? They just take a life of their own. And then you have millions of these kind of guys going out there and, you know, speaking like in very professorial tones as if this is actual fact, when it is the most ridiculous story you will ever hear in your life.
But most people don't realize we went to war in Antarctica with a contingency of the Nazis over not only secret technology, but the finds that the Nazis located in Antarctica, which they called New Schwabenland. And after the Nazis, which is called Operation Hijack, what specifically Majestic at that point was concerned about is that he would spill the beans on what was found in the Arctic. He would spill the beans on what was found in the Antarctic. He was anti-United Nations, so obviously the globalists of his day didn't like him for that. And the point is that he believed that because of the way we had handled the closing of World War II, that the international, if you will, Illuminists had pretty much taken control after World War II.
Well, I got to tell you, the Admiral Byrd story is one of the strangest I've ever heard, because it comes from someone of such credibility. And, you know, he had his diary. It's just a bizarre story. I mean, to have his plane, as you say, the engines cut off, and it's glided into this other land, Shangri-La, wherever it may be, within the center of the planet. You know, the curvature, I guess, is ever so slight. He never realized he was making that spin right into it. And then these beans taking advantage and helping him. They were good beans, apparently, and then they let him go, and off he went. What a story.
Well, it's a huge story. And again, if this was just some guy that was flaky, I mean, you have Richard Byrd in the history of the Navy is considered, and in the history of exploration, I mean, you don't have a better pedigree of a human being, or a braver man, a more adventurous man, a more honest man. So when you... But they can't assassinate his character.
Did he ever try to go public with this? Because he wrote these notes in a diary, but he really never said much about it when the events occurred when he came back, right?
Well, the whole thing is Forrestal and Byrd were planning on going together and going public with it. And Forrestal, basically, when he was suicided, Byrd went into kind of a, I guess you'd almost say, a self-imposed exile, from the standpoint that, you know, the only thing he would allow at that point is his diary to be released after his death.
That probably scared the heck out.
Oh, I'm so glad that, you know, the tag team duo, National Enquirer duo of George Noory and Steve Quayle are here to straighten everything out for us and tell us the whole truth. So this Byrd story must be true then, right? George Noory says so. Steve Quayle says so. Maybe I'm wrong after all. Anyhow, that's all she wrote, folks. See you another time soon.
As we move forward, anytime you come closer to something, your vision should get clearer. Am I right? You are a tool in the hidden hand that's using you. Please don't be delusional. The rulers of this world practice confusing you. The people and the priests and the imams have been jammed by government scams. Minds systematically programmed. Blatant black hatred and racism. The way they lace the whole world and nation with traces of Satanism. This place is a pagan prison. The founding fathers' enslaving intentions were no different than Bush's and Reagan's visions. 1776, it took action. This Illuminati took form and was spawned from a Colombian faction. Just flip your $1 bill over, and if you want me to expose the true code of deception, I will show you. We live in a designed wicked system. The number 13 is consistent in Masonic symbolism. It represents transformation. 12 completes a cycle, so 13 is rebirth and regeneration. The meanings of the symbol are strategically hid. On the left side you see a 13-layered pyramid. Over that sits the all-seeing eye where the light shines, a sign of the devil watching over you at all times. With the words Anuit Coeptis, 13 letters meaning he has favored our undertakings. Will you accept this? Or will you learn the science and ignore them? Under the pyramid you see Novus Ordo Seclorum. Translated, new order of the world, or the new world order. Authors and satanic fathers of mass slaughter. The eagle that you see on the right sits below 13 stars with a shield that has 13 stripes. And an olive branch in its claws with 13 leaves, which is supposed to be in its talon to represent peace. But peace was always on a decrease. His other claw holds 13 arrows of war, set to be released, and the letters at the bottom of the pyramid are fixed with the Roman numerals that equal 1776. The United States of America exists in a deep devilish abyss where truth and paganism mix. Every president that ever lived was foul. They gather at Bohemian Grove where they bow down before the owl. See the owl is wise and sees through the darkness of night. And there's a small one on the dollar near the one on the top right. It ain't hard to understand this government was never for us. The eagle was based off of the Egyptian hawk Horus. The 13 colonies grew into wicked sovereignty and made no apology for the obvious idolatry. Subconsciously, we follow the ways of the beast and pay homage to pagan gods when we say days of the week. Like Sunday, they worship the sun. Monday is moon day. Tyr, the god of war, was worshipped on Tuesday. Odin, the chief god, is who Wednesday is named for. Thursday is Thor's day, god of thunder, the mighty Thor. Friday was named after Frigga, notice the pattern. Saturday is the Roman god of agriculture, Saturn. Frigga was the goddess of love, the wife of Odin. The polytheistic theologies needed decoding. The rituals, like trips across the sand as man takes. The skull and bones fraternity, the secret handshakes. But understand, he receives only 33 degrees. He secretly believes in Lucifer and other deities. Many powerful and rich people are controlled by these. They even hold a soul of several of your favorite MCs. Politicians telling lies, tongues riddled with thorns, and use hand gestures shaped in the form of devil horns. You don't feel this any harm, cause you don't know what it entails. Satan tampers with stem cells and sprays chemtrails. The so-called holidays are hypocrisy, established to use religious doctrines to commit annual robbery. Christmas split in half is Christ's mass. The so-called birth of Jesus, where every home has glowing lights cast. Christ the anointed one masked the birth celebration, but Jesus' birth was kept secret due to the situation. The king initiated a death plot, cause the Messiah was prophesied to rule, so Jesus' murder was authorized. No one knows the actual date, that's why sometimes you see Xmas. X-Men's unknown, but ignorance affects us. A fraud that was purposely flawed. December 25th, the birthday of the wicked ruler Nimrod. His whole disguise is part of Satan's universal rise. A holy prophet's life being pimped and commercialized. Traditions like lights on trees, rooted in the Nicene Council in 325 AD. By Constantine, these matters were decreed. The concept of a virgin birth was actually conceived and then agreed. With graven images in the temple, the fish on your car is called Onis, a Babylonian symbol. It's visibly contradictory, telling your children lies. You need to make them study Santa Claus's sick history. But yet we go wherever Satan leads us. The falsehoods we practice in his name ain't got nothing to do with Jesus.
Yeah.